Christmas or Merry Holidays or Happy Holidays or whatever it is that you you celebrate at this time of the year, of course. This is James Corck, and with me I have Norman Sanzo.
Can I have cake?
No.
It will make me most happy.
Get away. You can. Do you have any idea what all that refined sugar is going to do to your loins? Get out. You have to look good for the fanboys, not to get mad. That's an innocent aside. We also have awesome brownie reviewer, Silver Quill.
The politically correct greeting for this holiday is hello, welcome to this nondescript event.
Yeah!
It's Xmas.
Xmas. Merry Christmas, Masperonis. There, I said it. And I don't regret it. If you don't want me to say Merry Christmas, then a call on you.
We all feel sorry for those who celebrate Kwanzaa, especially because they don't know what it is.
No. Bad James.
And a fine Festivus while we're at it.
Yeah.
Of course, nobody remembers that joke in Futurama where Bender, being a Santa Claus, meets up with the Kwanzaa bot, who's giving these books that they are titled directly, "What the Hell is Kwanzaa?" Oh, we start silly. We haven't smoked anything, guys. We're just like that. And on today's Christmassy episode, we're going to review something not Christmas related, so it makes sense, because, hey, why not? We are going to review the very last, very, very, very last of the micros, the Luna, Princess Luna micro, written by Katie Cook and drawn by Andy Price, with colors by the awesome Heather Breckel.
Yep.
And this one is... Okay, I'm not going to say anything. And I'm going to leave you guys to go ahead and talk about it, because these episodes have been a lot heavy on the James Corck. I want to tone that out, so... You guys have the floor. And like always, alphabetically inverted, so Silver goes first.
Mm-hmm. Well, I do consider this comic to be a good Christmas topic, because this is a gift to the bronies. Mm-hmm. Those of us who love Princess Luna and have wanted to see more of her. So here we have a comic devoted to her, and it is just a ton of fun. But it also raises the question of the comic portrayal of Princess Luna versus the TV show. And some fans, understandably, are not as big a fan of comic Luna because she is so bombastic, so energetic, whereas the Luna we've seen in the show after Luna eclipsed is more reserved, more proper, more trying to be regal. Personally, I'm more a fan of the crazy, energetic Luna who doesn't quite fit in yet. Because that's a little bit more identifiable with someone I root for. Not to mention, it's just fun. Mm-hmm. And that's what we see throughout this comic, as Luna finally not only gets to do some ruling, take center stage, we also get to see that being a princess is not just judging cake festivals and looking pretty for the audience. We get to see a side of Celestia we never get to see, right from the first panel on through. And we were treated to a ton of second-tier characters and one very prominent possum, which, I won't lie, confused the daylights out of me originally. It's like, what is this thing? Where did it come from? Oh, there's a back comic. Well, now it makes sense.
Yeah. As for me, how to put this? By the tone of my voice, you won't know that I'm a huge Luna fan because of that one episode I did with Final Draft, because he debated and I had to pick Celestia as my win point. So, yeah, no, I love Luna a lot. Like, Luna is, well, she's one of my favorite characters in the show, next to Derpy and Fluttershy and Rarity and Twilight and the rest of the ponies. Yeah, so on. But, yeah, in this one, I get to see more of her. And Andy Price drew her awesomely. I wish I had commissioned him to draw more of Luna. I wish I had more money for it. Honestly speaking, this comic, in terms of story, I love it. Because it's a story where you think you're better than me? You think my job is easy? Well, go ahead. Try it out. And yeah, Luna had to learn things the hard way. I love it. As James always says, I love to see my favorite character in pain.
Me with Rarity, you with Luna. Oh my gosh. I have to admit, it is... it's a difficult comic to talk about. Because it's the last of the micros. Mm-hmm. And you're reading it knowing that you are passing through the pages of a series that... It was meant to end at number 10, and they were not going to do more. Mm-hmm. So I don't know the thinking behind this comic. Maybe they were like, maybe we shall quit while we're ahead. And I totally agree with what Silver said. This comic celebrates Princess Luna like no other comic has. Even with the Reflections arc, and that one you could argue that it's more about Celestia and King Sombra than about Princess Luna. But even with her presence there, that wasn't enough of Luna on that comic. Mm-hmm. This comic, however, is Luna 100% all the time. And it is just... It is glorious because... I am not sure about you guys, but I have been there before. I know what it is to stay up for like 48 hours running nonstop, sleeping almost nothing. And just like you... tend to get very loopy, you tend to get very jumpy, and you tend to like rely heavily on like food and eating, and yes, you start like losing passion for even what you're doing. So besides, what a trooper Luna is. Like, she goes from the night shift right into the day shift without even taking a moment to rest. And what an enthusiasm. She is a great character in this comic. Yeah, I know, she's the protagonist. She has to be a great character, but she is such a good character in here because she's able to see passion into everything. Like, I love that one point where she's getting dragged to discuss about dancing and fireworks. And she doesn't want to go, but then she starts discussing with herself, saying, maybe talks about fire and dancing can be rather exciting. And then cut to her falling asleep in the middle of a meeting room, by going, ah. And it's like it's a perfect cut for a comic. The comedic timing is really good. And as usual with anything that comes from Andy Price, it's chock full of detail and a somewhat sympathetic vision of Flash Sentry, who happens to be afraid of possums. He has a possum phobia.
Oh God.
But yeah, I really like this comic, really loved it. It's in the same level with the Rarity Micro for me. Like, the Rarity Micro and the Luna Micro are the best micros of the entire series, in my opinion. And yeah, I really don't know what else to say other than, well, we should just go ahead and talk about what the comic is about.
Oh yeah, synopsis then.
In this one, we start with Princess Luna and Princess Celestia meeting up in the only time of the day that they are together, which is when the night and the day shift and change places. And they are having a conversation with Luna. Luna saying, oh, my work is so tough, taking care of the night and all that. And Celestia is like, well, taking care of the day is hard as well. It's also difficult. And then Luna takes that as a challenge, saying, oh, are you saying that the day shift is harder than the night shift? I'm pretty sure they can take care of the day shift, no problem. And then Celestia issues her challenge, saying, okay, I challenge you to take care of the day shift. So Luna takes upon herself to take care of the day shift, and right after that can be described of endless amount of hijinks ensue. Then they meet up at the end of the day. Luna admits that, yeah, taking care of the day shift is really hard. Please don't do it again. And so Celestia goes to sleep and leaves Luna to take care of the night shift. Because double middle finger to you if I had fingers. Goodbye, sister. Bye, night.
Just use Pinkie Pie's hoof trick and shoot her the bird.
Oh, God. Oh, I love this comic. Seriously, I love it. Like, rereading it is like a joy. I haven't read it for a while now, and I love it. I love every moment of it. So good.
From this point forward, we're going to just check the entire comic, like talking about each one of the panels or each one of the pages when necessary, of course. So, Get ready for it, because this being an underpriced comic, we're going to harp on every panel for like 5 minutes.
Let's try not.
There are tons of panels.
Let's try not. Let's just try and move along, because this is a long... Well, this is going to be a long one. But, oh God, let's just move on. Let's try and make this semi-short, but not really. Let's just enjoy yourself. Let's just enjoy yourself.
We can basically sum it with, oh my God, it's Luna! Luna, 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 Luna! Best princess ever!
Tetrapony is going to enjoy this.
it's impossible not to feel enthusiastic when you have such an interesting character going on there. Because I don't care what people say about, oh, Luna, she's not an interesting character. She's the dark horse of the fandom. Haha, see what I did there.
I will beat you up.
Look on TV Tropes to know what a dark horse is. But yeah, she's like the character that appears a little bit and the fandom just goes gaga for it. And there are people who don't get it, and I can kind of see where they are coming from, but at the same time, I don't give a crap. I root for Luna from beginning to end. And I love how bombastic she can get to be, but how dignified she can be as well. And that appears in every single one of the panels. she's always this... I'm doing this again. I am just talking about general discussion instead of talking panel page by page. You guys should take care of that. You are better at that than me.
No problem, man. I'm enjoying myself because, well, look, what can we say? Like, it's a comic dedicated to Luna. Luna!
But even from the first panel, though, it starts fleshing out Celestia.
Mm, I mean, true.
Where else never in the series are you going to see Celestia in a bathrobe with... Well, not a bathrobe, but a robe, with her hair tied in tails and looking so disheveled. That wouldn't be marketable to children. Oh my God, a princess who doesn't look great in the morning and has an I Hate Mondays mug?
Yeah.
I mean, it's right off the bat, it shows that they're not living a life of privilege. There's work to be done.
Oh, yeah.
And so much of this comic is Luna coming to realize that a leadership role is not just privileges. There's also a lot of responsibility. There can be a very stressful workload. It's everything I'd love for Twilight to learn in her new role, but I kind of doubt we'll ever truly see that. More on that when we reach the issues 25 and 26. Harumph. I'm sorry.
Silver, you were going so well, and then you go and get me angry. We don't talk about that.
Oh, we're going to talk about that when it's actually out.
Yeah, when it's out, but not now. Not now. We're not talking about it.
Since this is a Christmas episode and issue 26 is slated for release on Christmas Eve, Ronies, keep the Yuletide going. Yep, Let's lead the fan wars until the 26th.
Yep.
But I digress. Yeah, so basically, you have Luna just declaring she can handle the day shift as well as the night shift. And when you think about it, Celestia handled both shifts for 1,000 years. Mm-hmm. There's kind of a pride moment in here, a sense of, yes, I can live up to my sister. For even with her redemption, Luna's best characterization comes when she's kind of comparing herself to her sister still. What was it? For whom the sweetie bell toils. She talks about how Celestia outshines her very often.
Yeah, and with that, she has struggled. That is true.
That's true. So, and then there's this possum. It's just there. Hi.
Yeah.
And I do remember the first time I was reading through this, I kept looking at it like, where did this thing come from?
I know what you mean.
When did they introduce this possum named Tiberius?
Did they say his name at any point before the...
No, they didn't.
They don't say it. They say it at the end in the little comic that Katie Cook drew. Yes.
So when I read that comic, everything snapped into place, and I enjoyed a second and a third and a fourth reading.
To me, when Tiberius hears just this, like, what is this possum doing there? Like, okay, well, why is she there? Like, doesn't explain a dang thing. Like, why? Why is he there? He's almost everywhere. Like, wherever Luna is, he's there too. Like, what? And then, reading at that little comic, yeah, now I understand. Okay, now it makes things cuter.
Makes things cuter, but for the first time, I was like, I am so confused. but then, and speaking of character rollouts, then we get Kibitz.
Kibitz. Oh,
Kevitz. Oh, God, that guy.
He is awesome. He's awesome.
I'm going to argue against you, but okay. Let's go. What about Kevitz?
Well, his cutie mark should be an iron rod that rusted in place some time ago. But he's just fun. He's this wonderful foil to the energetic Luna. And I'm jumping to, like, the third page where Celestia wishes them a good day, emphasis on day. And Luna is basically skipping to the throne, bouncing on it. Probably her most adorable pages. Mm-hmm. And here's Kibitz just insisting on schedules. He has a bran muffin ready for her.
Oh, God, the bran muffin part makes stomach churn.
She says, "We shall renegotiate the bran muffin part. That displeases me."
I just like the panel after that. This meal is the embodiment of disappointment.
But that says something, that here even Kibitz can make a princess follow what his agenda. Mm-hmm. I mean, so he could be kind of intimidating, I think.
But technically it's the whole, your sister does this, I too shall follow this, and I shall be better than my sister. Ha ha!
Aha!
But Kibitz is awesome. Like, he's the guy that, how do I put this? He's the friend that you don't want to have around, but is really handy to have around if you want to get things done.
And he's also suffering in his own way as he tries to deal with Luna's unorthodox approaches.
Mm-hmm. So it's Go ahead.
So it's just a back and forth. It's Luna is suffering Kibitz's stuffiness, and Kibitz is suffering Luna's bombastic explosions and randomness.
I just love her. Oh, there's so much. I just love her.
I love the fact that Kibitz doesn't. He is authoritarian and kind of like hard when it comes to it, but he never comes off as unlikable or insufferable or bad. They actually make him rather sympathetic because there is usually this kind of like, let's not forget, people in command, rulers, they are also people. So they are flawed. They want to have fun. They want to go there and enjoy things, but they need to have that other person that kind of like, you know, pulls them in and riles them up and is like, no, you are derailing. You have to go back into the rails. You have to keep doing things right. And that's Kibitz. And he is such a, towards the end especially, he's such a sympathetic guy. Like how Luna, she's just fed up with the stupid watch, so she throws it out of the window. That is my grandpony's watch. And I'm like, aww.
Oh, I know.
That was rather sad.
I know.
I'm going to assume that she can magically retrieve it or restore it, because otherwise Luna's kind of a jerk.
Yep.
But Kibitz endears himself very early on as Luna's using the telescope to make sure everything's okay. Which, yeah, you know, sometimes I've wondered if Celestia looked out at Ponyville with her telescope and was like, oh, there's a dragon stomping through that looks just like Spike. Oh, there's parasprite infestation. Oh, my sister's driving the ponies crazy. Does this town ever have a normal day?
Apparently when Luna's looking at it.
Apparently, but here's Luna saying the peasantry looks nice, and Kibitz is like, it's really not good to call them peasantry. And here's Luna using all these archaic, as is appropriate, terms, but they're also kind of inherently and unintentionally disrespectful. And you think, oh, thank goodness Kibitz is there to avert disaster.
Oh, here's the thing. The episode Luna Eclipse, that episode would have been a bit boring, but really interesting if Kibitz was there just to rile in Luna.
Then Twilight would have gone to shine.
I know, but
Twilight would have been completely rendered useless.
But it would be a funny show if he was there, like, Princess Luna, please cease what you're doing. Oh, think of the children. I just love. He's the underdog of this comic. He's just there. Like we've all been saying, like, oh, Luna's awesome. Luna's awesome. But Kibitz's just there. Like, hey, I'm just doing my job.
Well, it's kind of like the relationship between Maud and Pinkie Pie.
Mm-hmm.
Maud was so much fun because she had Pinky to play off of. Alone, she might have been pretty boring. Luna is fun and energetic, but she's even funnier standing next to this stuffed shirt. Mm-hmm. And by the same token, Kibitz is more sympathetic because he has to try and reel in this unpredictable princess.
Oh, true.
So it's a brilliant odd couple. It may actually surpass Applejack in rarity.
Oh, yeah. I just love the scene where they're delegating between the Flim Flam brothers and the Spa Ponies. No, that's not Spa Ponies, but who was it again?
I have no idea, Wheatgrass, that was...
And, Wheatgrass and Tall... Oh, what was it? The Hippie Ponies.
Yeah, the Hippie Ponies, yeah.
Wheatgrass and the other guy who's completely stoned off his butt. Yes. That was very King Solomon style.
I know!
I like that. I was like, wow, I cannot believe they actually threw a reference to King Solomon into this comic book. It is brilliant.
And I just love the part. The second problem is still with the Flim Flam brothers and you sheep now.
But before we get to the King Solomon, we have the inspection of the military.
Oh yeah.
Oh yes, and that one was fun.
Yeah.
Well, as you say, we finally get something for Flash Sentry. I mean, my God, this comic even fleshes out the most despised male character in the show.
Yes.
And okay, fine. Being startled by a possum is hardly in-depth analysis, but at least it shows him something other than grin and look cute for Twilight. I will say I'm a little critical of the artwork on just this page, because when, especially on the last panel, when you look at Flash Sentry, he's got some sort of turquoise drape over
that,
and his armor loses a lot of the armor. And even the legs on the ponies kind of melts into one another. I get the sense that they were under the gun and this panel or this page was a little rushed.
Probably not. I'm not sure. It could be artist note for who is this header to color in. I don't know.
And this page also certifies that the Royal Guard does nothing.
Oh, they do, but
absolutely
not in
time
of crisis.
Not. They don't. Poor Luna is expecting at least a tale of adventure, and they're talking about the things they found on their hooves.
But what about that appearance at the big sale at the Philly school down in Ponyville?
I can kind of see what you mean with their legs kind of like confusing into each other, but then I didn't think about maybe they were under pressure to get it done, but I think the facial expressions are kind of like more stock and kind of like not refined. Because if you look at Flash's face towards the end, if you didn't tell me that was Flash Sentry at the beginning of the page, I wouldn't have been able to tell if it was him.
Yeah.
Well, to
like,
be honest,
that face is weird.
Well, to be honest, we wouldn't expect him to be there. I mean, he's supposed to be in the Crystal Empire. Or as I call it, the gathering place of all things disappointing.
But I think the timing's a bit
I have enough,
different.
I have enough friends in the military to know that you get transferred all the time. So maybe one day you will be working on the Crystal Empire and another day you will be working in Canterlot and maybe you're going to get sent to Las Pegasus next time. Or because it's like they, at least when it comes to the military, you are an asset. They don't see a person, they see a group of people that are there as a line of defense. So if that works similarly in the equestrian military, I guess there is constant transferring between one and the other. Don't they at the end of Equestria Girls, they say Flash Sentry got transferred to the Crystal Empire not long ago?
They say he just joined, which is a very vague expression. He may have just signed up for service.
It is possible that he got to sign up because if the Rainbow Falls episode, not the one for the Equestria Games, the Treya. If Treya is an indication of anything, Crystal Ponies and Normal Ponies and Pegasi and Unicorns and all that, they all met, they all mingle together every now and then. So I guess it will kind of make sense to have a mixed military force.
Probably.
Because then again, that is kind of forward, to have different races working together for the common, the greater good. Mm-hmm.
The greater good. Shut
the
it.
The greater good. we are harping on a little detail on the Luna comic.
Well, that's what we do. That's how we move.
Which is why when we move forward to this mysterious figure who looks like it needs to be arrested, prowling the alleyways, and the password is Hoofacure. Here's the second fleshing out for Celestia. My God, she knows how to relax in style.
I know. Honestly,
oh, she's so good.
Honestly, when I first read this, I thought, oh, who's this person? Who's this bad guy for Luna? Oh my God, is Luna going to solve some mystery? Nope, it's just Celestia.
It's Celestia.
Love it.
I love but how it's... this hoity-toity spa is inside a condemned building.
Oh, it's only for the elites, yo.
Celestia probably blew half the equestrian budget on this day. But, oh, here I am. Here I am trying to say, oh, Celestia's a tyrant or a bad ruler. No, she's having fun.
But it's actually the first time that they direct funds to finance a personal project.
I would just say that it's nice. Kibitz will later say, oh, I'm sure your sister is watching from the shadows, ready to step in. No, she's giving herself a day.
Yep.
She's behaving like a real character.
Not the
eternally wise. These comics do such a great job of showing her more flippant side.
Yep.
And I guess, James, when you say that this is like right up there with Rarity, I don't disagree. But I'm afraid this has such good company in Rarity, Pinky, and Celestia that it's very hard to really rank them all. Because this and the Celestia Micro all flesh out the Royal Sisters in such wonderfully diverse and real ways.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I love about it. Including paperwork, which is what Luna has to deal with next.
Oh, God, not the paperwork. Anything but the paperwork.
It is funny. We've only seen Celestia doing paperwork once, although it was a mighty stack.
Oh, God.
It was a big mighty stack. But, yeah, we only saw her signing documents at the beginning of Season 3. By the way, at the end of the review, I vote for picking the favorite comics of the Micro series, because being this the last one, we have to do that. And I love what you said about the Pinky Celestia Rarity and Luna Micro, saying that they are you cannot rate them. That is one point that I want to hammer at the end of the review, but not now. Let's focus on the Luna comic, and then we do the reviewing of the entire series at the end.
Challenge accepted.
Oh my!
Yes, you go.
I don't know if there's much to say about paperwork that's teased, but we start to see Luna finally saying, "How does my sister do all of this?"
Mm-hmm.
So here's the dawning of appreciation for both the audience and Luna, because in a weird way, Luna is a stand-in for the audience assuming what Celestia's day is like.
Oh, true.
And being presented with a very stark reality. And again, I think I've harped on the presentation of a princess as a ruler in the past, that it's supposed to set an example. We market the princesshood to little girls as this life of privilege and everyone will love you. Rarely do we try to enforce you have to live up to a lot of demands. And here we see it. And I love it.
In the terms of Equestria, there's no a higher ruler than princess, except for Queen Chrysalis and Queen of the Crystal Empire. But to date, we only have the princesses to look upon. In terms of ruler, they can't be, well, sitting on their butts doing nothing or being pretty. They have to do other things too. And since there's no other ruler than them, they have to step up.
And yet the image we're presented is usually them sitting on their butts looking pretty.
Well, that's only in the cartoon, not in the comics.
Yeah. High praise for the comics.
Rejoice.
Yay.
And then there was much rejoicing.
Yay.
Yay.
But anywho, moving on past the Flim Flam Brothers and the King Solomon insert, what is it? Parody? Not parody, what's the word I'm looking for?
Reference,
thank you. The King Solomon reference. We head off to, well, the time is just only 9 a.m. They haven't done much.
And we keep getting these great Luna expressions. Kibitz asks, do you know what Princess Celestia would do if we were behind on our docket? Luna's just sort of glaring away, rejoice. See, again, there's that great dynamic, that back and forth is one seems oblivious and the other is just sort of snarky. And it'll change back and forth. Kibitz's snark, as we even saw in the Reflections comic, is more inside his own head.
And the next panel is awesome. I love the next panel.
Where Tiberius is trying to feed her a bug?
Yeah, that Andy Price loved to do this, like insert background things. Like, you're concentrating on the main characters, which is the ponies. But if you take a look, see what Tiberius is doing. Okay, first page, that panel where he found a bug, hug it. Oh, I love this bug. Shows it to Luna. And then like, it's the bug.
I love it because in one panel he's just hugging it with hearts coming out of his head. And then the next one, it is hilarious.
I take that back one step, one page above, one panel above. He spots the bug.
Yeah.
He hugs the bug, shows the bug, eat the bug, offers the bug. Like, oh my god, those little details. If you don't really pay attention, my goodness, I love Andy Price.
It is brilliant. Because you can have a separate storyline going on. You can totally follow the comic just being following Tiberius. And even with that, you can have a lot of fun going on with him.
Yeah. And the next page is awesome.
Well, yeah, speaking of fun, you see the dichotomy of lives between Celestia and Luna at this moment. Yes. Including, and you may not see this on the first read-through, but all those notes from Twilight Sparkle suddenly take on a very different meaning. would you see Luna trying to answer each one? My dear sister student, you need more free time.
Dear Twilight Sparkle, get away from your email.
I art sending thou Flash Sentry. Do with him as you please.
Oh, God. Oh, my.
Take pictures, please.
But I'm looking at the... Ooh. I'm looking at the scene where Luna is bringing the pets for a walk, and there's two corgis, and who are those?
Well, corgis are officially seen as the royal pets of the British monarch.
Yeah. All right, I remember that.
And finally, Philomena gets to have some screen time. I mean, well, she was in the Celestia Micro as well, but my goodness, she disappeared.
And then the next panel is Celestia. Oh god, she's having a good time. Oh god.
What is it? Andy Cook's skill at expressions. It wasn't there for the guard ponies, but it's there for Celestia getting a massage.
Oh my god. That
crack.
Is...
Oh god!
That is a complete and absolute guilty pleasure page because yeah. I am enjoying this for all the wrong reasons.
No, you shush.
No, shut up! I love this. I want to frame it and just hang it on the wall and have people ask me why are you having that on there? And I'm like, because it's sexy. Anyway,
but looking at it, like. You can tell by her expression she's enjoying herself, and I want that. I want what she's having.
I want that too.
Her expressions are eclipsed by the next page, where Luna starts feeling the drain. Yeah, yeah. And while I said earlier that the scenes where she's bouncing on the throne and running with the scroll in her mouth are adorable in their own way, this is a different kind of attraction.
Just this, totally different, yes.
Yeah. Yes, her eyes are half closed. I can hurt you.
I'm just wondering, like, Celestia's mane, how long is it?
As long as the screen needs it to be.
Yeah,
it is super long. But now we finally know what kind of shampoo does she use.
Pink Bubbly? That's all I can think of the name for it.
Pink Bubbly. No, it's like, it is good to see that. I also love the way that Andy Price draws the head of the princesses in this... in the comics, because it still has that ethereal feel to it. It still has the stars flowing in Luna's mane and the aurora feel on Celestia's, but it feels like real hair. Like you can see the strands of hair. You can see the different hairs flowing within it, and I am like, that is so cool. That is really cool. I like that. That, yeah, thumbs up. That is good.
there'll be a great scene later for Luna's main flow. But in the meantime, we can focus on Luna. Can I have cake?
Yes. And no, it's only 12 p.m. So it's like, wow, all that work done and nothing much has happened. Like, oh my. Yeah.
Like 4 hours worth of the daily routine have just passed by. And it's like, they have done so many things that yet it's going so slow.
But the dialogue between Luna and Kibitz, you know, do you know what cake would do to you? It would make me happy.
It would make me happy.
I just love the panel above it. I can hurt you. I'm sure you could, but if you do, you'll never get your lunch.
See, and again, there's that great relationship, the wordplay.
I know.
What a smug guy Kibitz is. He's like, I know I am in control here. You're not going to play games with me. I don't care if you are an eternal being, like he's 1,000 years old, and you were trapped in the moon because you were trying to take over Equestria. I am going to smack down Tokyo. I love this guy. You know what? I didn't feel much for Kibitz, but you guys are making me fall in love with this guy because he's so good.
I know.
He's so sure of himself. I love people like that.
Yeah.
That is brilliant.
And after the cute cake scene, like, oh God, that expression is so cute. I want a full scene of it to draw. I want it as a wallpaper. Someone, get onto it.
The next page with Luna reflecting on the affairs of the day and the vitality to it. Mm-hmm. Great use of the stained glass behind her to show the two different lifestyles. There's not a lot to pontificate on, just that, this is the part where Kibitz says, oh, I'm sure your sister's watching. Nope, she's out cold.
with
cucumbers on her eyes.
Yep. But I just love the interaction between Kibitz and Luna here, like him trying to reassure that, hey, Luna, you're doing a good job. Don't doubt yourself. And after that, and if you can't handle it, I'm sure your sister in the shadow, ready to step back into her duties.
The swell of reassurance has been ruptured. That might be better than the fun has been doubled.
I know! It's like...
Yeah. No, this also kind of tells you one thing about Princess Celestia, that she has complete and absolute confidence in her sister. Mm-hmm. Enough to go get a spa treatment and just fall in sleep with cucumbers on her face. Because why? She knows that Luna is going to take care of everything. One way or another, even if she's sleep deprived and not doing very well at the beginning, she is going to take care of things. Mm-hmm. That is very cool. Because it shows that Celestia has complete and absolute confidence in her sister. Mm-hmm. By the way... Am I the only one who notices that Tiberius is noticing Celestia in the other panel? He's pointing and he's like, oh, look at that!
Fourth-wall breaking!
Well, Tiberius is often crawling between the panels, which is just a fun visual gag that Price Cook put in there. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Now, James, when you talk about drawing the mains so beautifully, as they're en route to the garden, and it's sort of a high-angle shot of Kibitz and Luna,
yes,
the way Luna's mane is flowing is just beautiful.
Yeah,
it is beautiful. I agree with you. It is so pretty.
If I were to draw this, I would never have thought about that. Like, Andy Price, like, his ideas, like, oh, God.
But then we get to the chess scene.
Before we move on, though, like, I just like how Kibitz here forgot his green highlighter and he can't do anything without it. Like, everything must be put on hold. I need to get it. Like, he and Twilight will get along perfectly.
They totally would.
Yeah. Maybe he's the one who had an impact on Twilight's organization.
Probably.
But anyway.
Also, may I say that I love the way Luna looks with the sunglasses, the handkerchief over her head, the hat. Also, I just noticed the hat has a Batman symbol on it.
I know. Or a bat symbol. It's not a Batman, but it's just bat.
No, shut up. It's Batman. It has the same shape of a batarang. It is a Batman symbol. I love that. But yeah, chess scene.
Oh, God.
I mean, the individual panels are fun and energetic, but it's the overall approach and Luna's competition and the way she's just using the ponies, Kibitz's reaction when he returns and their wordplay. And the final image of Luna being dragged off. shouting at Fancy Pants, "Don't move, we'll continue this later." I mean, it's comedy gold.
I know.
And then we get a little more of Celestia just living the good life. She has total confidence in the sister, but she also is like, I am going to enjoy this day to the fullest.
I just love last panel there. It's like puffy cheeks and
wow, dude, you are really going fangasm here.
I know.
It's kind of like you like Celestia or something like that. I don't know.
Hey. I just love good comics and I love good characters. And what I see here, I like.
Yes, and I like the greatest line in the comic, fire shining armor. Fire him. He's still good at being a prince.
No.
You're fired.
No.
Shining armor. Donald Trump called. You're fired.
No.
you're fired, shining armor. Why am I fired? Because you're a flat character and nobody cares for you.
Let's we move on to the next
the
panel.
The only thing people want you for is to ship them with their OCs and show shots of your butt.
That's the only thing
you know how to do.
We show more of Luna's reaction to the bureaucracy of being a leader, which I would put any soul to sleep, I think.
Yeah. Oh, God. Even if you're not sleep deprived, you will fall asleep with it.
Oh, yeah. I just love how Kabix is just pulling Luna by the tail.
Oh, yes. And on the following panel where this pink pony is saying soon Luna has to approve all the opening ceremonies. They're approved! Oh, no. You can't approve without reviewing. That'd be silly. I would like to mention how many laws have passed through the American Congress without even being read.
Oh, God.
Oh, I wish I were joking. It's funny in a tragic way.
Oh, let's not start with that.
That, you're saying that Equestria has a better bureaucracy than the U.S.
I will totally say that. They've got monarchs that genuinely care about their subjects. They've got what Britain wishes they had. Medieval Europe wanted Celestia and Luna as rulers.
So true.
In America, we want politicians who care. But now I am going on a political tangent. Let's talk about the festival with the Observer.
I found Waldo.
Oh, yes. Where was
he?
Yeah,
there is a Waldo in there. It's right next to the giraffe.
Hello.
I love that. That is another one of those Andy Price shots. Yep. That is like only Andy Price is able to pull off something like this. It's chock full of detail. You can spend the entire day looking at this panel and trying to, like, because all of these characters, they all have their own stories. Hell, there is even a Magnum PI cameo with a super awesome sports car being pulled off by two Doberman.
And also we see Derpy there. Yep.
And I'm glad you say that all these characters have a story, because that's something that I fear gets lost in the main six click, that it's all about our heroines. We kind of forget this. There's a world around them.
Yeah, there's something outside of that.
And that their actions have an impact on said world.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I mean, after Ne'er-do-well, how many people said, well, how many Ponyvillians were disappointed by the disappearance of their hero?
Don't care, not part of the story. Move along.
I'm gonna have at this, because this is what the comics does well. It makes this world alive.
Oh, true.
It makes this world more real, oftentimes more than the cartoon. That's a great strength.
It's three-dimensional. It feels, like you said, it makes the world feel alive. There is something outside of that.
Like you guys said, with Andy, he puts a lot of details. And if you look at the cart for the circus, it says Faust's Traveling Circus. Like, Faust, who else do you know has that name?
Well,
it's Air Traveling Circus, of course.
Yeah. And Observatory looks on it.
Although I am always curious that Andy Price must love that character Sweet Cream, the one who's doing the balancing on the line.
Oh, yeah, that one.
That's the pony who keeps hitting on Big Macintosh.
Yeah.
Yes.
So and she looks like a recolored Twilight Sparkle. I just wonder, what is his fascination with this one character?
Well, Silver, if we get Andy on, I'll be sure to ask him.
And he'll probably say, wow, you guys have really been reading into this too much.
No, we're not reading into it. We're just asking why you like this character so much.
Oh.
Nerds! We are nerds!
And finally, we come to the breakdown.
Oh, no.
The anger within Luna has reached its boiling point. And we were treated to... We talked last week about the power ponies and the heavy use of inking and thickness of line strokes to convey this sense of power. Mm-hmm. You ain't getting more powerful than having frickin' bats come out of your wings.
Yeah, that's metal. That's metal.
Bruce Wayne is looking at this and saying, that's my pony.
That's my pony.
I have to give this to Heather. Like, the coloring in this panel, top-notch. Awesome job. There's so much win in this.
And while Luda throwing Kibitz's watch is a pretty jerk move, I cannot help but support her in wadding up that schedule and stuffing it down his throat. Assuming he's not dead.
Nope, he's not.
I actually kind of like... I am like, yeah, screw your watch. I think at this point, Luna has done... She's 120% done with Kibitz, his schedule... The watch, the everything, he said, he's like, no, out the window. I love Kibitz, but that's kind of justified. You are like, no, screw that, I'm done with this.
Well, you could levitate it down the rest of the way, I'm just saying.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, but... it's thrown out the window, but I think that is part of the joke. Although,
But this is Luna's triumph here at the end, where she says she stops trying to be Celestia, and she starts doing it herself, her way. And it looks like she's doing it really well, and not only that, but enjoying it more, which is a nice lesson for younger readers. Mm-hmm. You don't try and mimic someone who's had much more experience. You find your own way down the path. And it's pretty fun to see her listening to Applebloom talk about lack of cutie mark or rewarding Fleetfoot for surviving horrible firecracker incidents.
Yay.
Flim and Flam... Good Lord, they should have, like, their own room just at the castle. So you've been accused again. We'll prepare your usual digs.
Hey, guys, I need to ask you something. Like, the Apple Bloom scene here, that scene, that whole setup reminds me of a show. But what kind of show does that, eh?
Didn't Sesame Street have talks on atop brick walls?
Yes. That was kind of like Sesame Street.
Okay. It could be that. Because it reminds me so much of a childhood show I watched before. So if you're talking Sesame Street, yeah, probably.
It's most likely a callback to Sesame Street. Although, now that you said Sesame Street, I cannot think of other shows that do that same thing.
Who's that one guy that's...
Oh, wait, no, Peanuts.
Peanuts.
It's Peanuts.
Yeah, Peanuts. Yeah, no, you're right, it's Peanuts. It is Peanuts.
Okay. Not Uncle Phil? No, not Uncle Phil. Who's that guy?
I don't know if I want to hear about your Uncle Phil. This usually starts with a bad story.
No. That one guy who's really awesome, who's talked to children and whatnot. Like, has a...
Mr. Rogers?
Yeah, Mr. Rogers. No? He doesn't do that?
Not that I'm aware. He had his own little home.
Okay.
And he was a great guy. God, I miss that kind of programming. That's why I like Friendship is Magic.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I got no idea about Uncle Mr. Rogers because we don't have that show when we were growing up.
I'm sorry.
I know.
But, and finally, Celestia makes her less than triumphant return, but it's like she says, oh, it was rather mean of you to give her all that at once. It was mean of you to saddle her with this day, Missy. You have your faith in your sister, but I still see a little Trollestia coming out here.
Well, technically, Luna kind of asked for it because knowing Celestia kind of knew, like, hey, today's not a good day for you to tackle my job, but nope, I will do it, I'll do it, I don't care what you say, I'll do it. Like, okay, if you want to, troll.
I get the sense that there's no day that would be good to take over Celestia's role.
You don't want to take so much responsibility.
Well, there's always the wedding
Great. Luna getting locked up in that cocoon.
Yeah. It was pretty easy.
Actually, that might have been the one day Celestia got to have some rest.
Yeah.
But, and then, I'm sorry, but it is pure trollishness for Celestia to go to bed and leave the 48-hour shift. Well, maybe it's only 24, but it's still demanding.
Well, think about this for a second. You cannot... Okay, imagine that They didn't really know that Celestia was doing this. Like, what are they going to do next? Luna has to keep taking care of the knight. Mm-hmm. You cannot throw the responsibility back to others. Mm-hmm. She has to still take care of that. Then after this night shift, he's going to go back to sleep, and Celestia is going to return to the daily routines, and that's it. However, it goes to the same... It goes to the same basics as what Norman was saying before. I love to see my favorite characters suffer. And that is just more suffering on Luna's side.
Whereas I, if I were trying to create a model of fairness, Celestia says, sister, take a 6-hour nap. You can take up the latter part of the night. I'll handle it for here. For 6 hours.
Yeah, but no.
But there we go.
Lesson we learn.
Well, at this point, the lesson has been learned. Now it's just, sister, squeal for me.
Yay. And those poor chess ponies. Those poor chess ponies.
And Tiberius gives us thanks for 10 issues of a very well-done series.
Mm-hmm. Great job. And let's touch upon the small comic by...
Katie Cook. Yeah. Which, by the way, I have to say, her style is absolutely adorable.
You know.
Like, completely, totally adorable. And also, I love the little Fluttershy cameo.
Spider sense is tingling.
Oh, that's why. She can sense spiders. That is so useful. I want that so I can squash them dead.
Hey.
I hate spiders. You are not going to convince me otherwise.
Yeah, I have arachnophobia.
Same here, dude. I mean, good grief.
Then you're going to hate the next comic arc.
No.
Or at least the cover.
But anywho.
I was going to say, it stinks to be one of Luna's Royal Guards unless you have a good chiropractor. Maybe they should get a day at Celestia's spa.
Oh, yeah. I just love the page when they say, oh, an owlbear, tempting as a friend, but you may be, I fear, copyright issues.
Yeah, I'm afraid that one went over my head. Is Dungeons & Dragons have an owlbear copyright?
I probably think so. You know what? I'm going to risk it, and I'm going to do a Google search. I'm going to go do the Google search and see what's related to owlbears.
Well, either way, it's as I said at the beginning, it's so funny that this made the rest of the comic make more sense. But at the but Tiberius... And, yeah, we see him again in the Reflections arc. So, it's nice that he'll be a returning piece of the scenery.
Okay, got it. It's a D&D reference.
Yep, D&D.
What is?
The owlbear.
The owlbear, yeah, right.
I'm rather surprised it wasn't based on some mythology.
But, yeah, no. But you know what? If an owlbear is D&D and Hasbro owns D&D, what's wrong?
Well, it's more than that, I think. One, I think Hasbro bought D&D from another company that went under.
Really?
Well, the thing it is true, because Wizards of the Coast owns D&D, and Hasbro owns Wizards of the Coast, because they also own Magic the Gathering. Mm. So, yeah.
But one of the fickle natures of copyright is that even if you have the same parent company, rights to an intellectual property are divided up very specifically. Yes. And you have to go through a mountain of paperwork to make sure everything is clearly defined within the law. So it's a huge hassle. And yeah, I think it is possible for one company to sue another, even if they are owned by the same parent corporation, because the law can be that crazy.
Wow. That's not fair.
It's fair and right are not always the same thing.
But anywho, after the whole scene of the owlbear, Luna tries to look for a pet, bats, owls, skunk, and found possum. And oh god, that squee, like, eee! I will name you Tiberius, and you shall be my Tiberius kid.
You've been making that squee for half this comic.
I know!
Peebles.
Our day is nearly done. No, it ain't.
No, it isn't.
No, it isn't.
That's Luna's micro. End.
That's the end of it. But, yep. And just think about that for a second. It is the end of it. And with that, it's the end of the micro series.
Mm-hmm.
Which, what a great run.
Yep.
Well, like, I won't say it was a run without some potholes. Fluttershy micro.
Hey.
Oh, God. Yeah, that one.
But, sorry, but I look at the big picture, and you know, there are strengths, there are weaknesses, but all in all, it usually celebrates the ponies we enjoy.
Mm-hmm. True that. And well, James, you take the reins on this one because you said you wanted to do a scale of 1 to 10.
Yeah, because it's the last micro. It's the end of the series. We are not going to talk about any other micros ever again because. Mm-hmm. There is no other is going to come out. The only way that we are going to talk about the micros is if we are having a casual conversation and talking about them. Mm. So I think it only makes sense to talk about this comic series and call the best and the worst, and giving any other titles when needed.
All right.
So I vouch for. Inverted alphabetical order because it leaves me to the end.
All right.
Makes everything easier, and I like to put my friends forward because I don't consider my opinion all that important. Hey. But I value yours, so I like to listen to yours first. So, like before, Silver, then Norman, then me.
Okay. So you want me to rank all 10?
Well, if you want to, yeah.
I can try. I will try.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, go ahead, man.
So from unfortunately the bottom, so building up to the top, I'm sorry to say that Fluttershy's micro occupies the bottom of the totem pole. It's just it wasn't a strong showing of her. It was more a celebration of rarity, and its views on criticism were very one-sided. That there's a lot to the art of criticism, said the guy who does a review show. Next up is Rainbow Dash. It's strange that the Pegasi are the low flyers on this list. There was a greater external conflict, but we didn't really get to know Rainbow all that well or really feel her struggle. And so I felt like it was an event that had a lot of pop culture references, but not a lot of character substance. Then comes Spike's micro, which is just stuff happened. Spike was there. Again, some jokes and some interesting commentary on Krevolution, but not a lot of impact. Applejack's micro was pretty much just a safe Applejack story. She's stubborn. There's her family. Nothing that really brought new things to the table, but I feel like it didn't drag her character down. Or wasted. It just didn't take any risks. Now I need to sift through. I believe Twilight Sparkle is next. It celebrates Twilight's character and not her magical ability in a very unexpected way. But as the first micro, we were all expecting sort of an adventure. And it turned out to be something very different. I think people were disappointed by that. But for what it is, I think it's a very well done tale of how Twilight can make friends by being sincere with them. So let's see here. Who's left? Then we come to Princess Luna. And I know we've been singing his praises this review. It's not that I think it's a bad micro by any stretch, but it's in such good company. The big thing that separates it is that this Luna in the comics is a very stark contrast to the show Luna. And the ponies we'll see in my top three are pretty much, I see those stories as carrying forward to the show. I'm not sure how TV show Luna would react to the situation as opposed to comic book Luna. So it's fun. I love it. It's got great artwork. It's got great characters. It's got great humor. But I'm not sure if I can say, yeah, this is what Luna in the show would do.
I have to agree with you when it comes to that, is that show Luna and Prince and comic Luna are completely different characters at this point.
Mm-hmm. Now, the Celestia micro, we don't get to see a lot of Celestia. So, again, this is kind of up to supposition. But this is showing her at her best. Wise, patient, experienced. Key word there. You know, a lot of people like to just sort of assume she's kind of infallible by nature, or sometimes that's how the show presents it. But I've always viewed her as a thousand years leads to a ton of experience. And that comes through in this comic. And also her role with the world outside Twilight Sparkle. And so I say, yeah, I could see the show Celestia being like this. Then comes Pinkie Pie, which, oh my goodness, that's the show Pinkie right there. and the only comic to spawn its own musical. So I love that. It was everything great about Pinky. It was everything about Pinky that sometimes doesn't go right, but is still very much in character. And then at the top of the poll, the highest rung, Rarity, who is always taking us by surprise. You think, oh, I could never really care about a story about a fashion show and time at a day spa. Here's Rarity saying, oh, yes, you could. And I did. And it was glorious. So I believe I've covered everybody.
Wow.
Applejack Rainbow, yeah, yeah. Oh, the Cutie Mark Crusaders, I left them out.
Oh, how could you?
How could I indeed? Well, you know, it's like this, it's the Scootaloo syndrome. She gets overlooked so quickly. I'm going to put them just above Twilight's comic, but after Twilight, so higher up there, but not quite on par with Celestia. Beautiful artwork and a really fun story, but didn't really give us a chance to see how each Crusader contributed to the whole. They were more sort of a group mind.
As for me, I'm making up my list as we speak. And, well, okay, number 10 for me is going to be the AJ comic because, how would I put this? Poor AJ, her story's always been, I'm stubborn, I don't want help, and it's a rehash of the whole third or fourth episode from the show. So, yeah, I don't need that in my micro. And I've always been from the point where the micros are a character. What's the word I'm looking for? Character study on each character. And with Applejack, I learned nothing from her. It's just average at best. And, well, age is number 10. Number 2 for me is Rainbow Dash. And, yeah, Rainbow Dash. Can't say much. Don't remember much. Awesome comic, I guess, but yeah, I don't remember much. Number 8 for me is going to be Spike. I had a fun conversation with you guys, but the most memorable part of the conversation was about Crevolution.
That's right, you all respect
it. I don't remember much about Spike.
It's not that bad, but like I had more fun talking about Crevolution. And I debate this with myself, and I hate putting the CMCs at number 7 because they had beautiful art, beautiful story, and an awesome lesson. But compared with the rest that's on the list, they have to be at number 7. Number 6 for me is going to be Fluttershy. I love how, well, you guys have your own opinion about it, and I had my own opinion that I said it on the review, but for her, she needs to have more confidence, and she believes in her art, and well, Rarity, like you said, Rarity is the main pony that has pushed her to develop that sense of confidence. Number 5 for me is going to be the Pinkie Pie Micro. Awesome art, awesome lesson. Yet again, compared to the rest, it's hard. Number 4 is Twilight, the Twilight Micro. I just love how this first try showed that Twilight knew who she was, yet still didn't, well, blab about it. Like, I know who you are. You're my hero. Senpai, please sign my comic. So she just played it cool because, well, there's a reason why she didn't want to be found out. So why should I, well, blur it out? Awesome. Number 3 is the Tia Micro. Awesome lesson, awesome art. Love it. Just love it. And now here comes the hard part. Really hate to do this, but number 2 is going to be Rarity. Love so...
Oh, Norman, you say it like I am about to shank you with a knife in the parking lot. Why are you so scared?
James, attack. Punish.
James, you shank. It's so effective. But honestly speaking, I love the comic, love the art, love the lesson. But number 1, Luna. Make me giggle, make me squee. Like, oh god, there's so much good in that comic. And the lesson there is, be true to yourself, and one person's job is may look easy, but it's not. That's the big lesson there. And James?
Well... Do I really need to Oh yeah, you guys don't. Okay. Well, this is going to be difficult because to me there is no a bad micro. There are just micros that are absolutely fantastic, and then others that are completely watered down and uninteresting. I think I should, well, not completely watered down and interesting, but they have a few things that I don't like. But then mm-hmm. again, what do I know? Mm-hmm. Okay, well, I'm going to do like you guys did. Start with the ones that I didn't like and finish with the ones that I did like a lot. The one that I liked the least was the Applejack one. Mm-hmm. Mostly because in the Applejack comic, the ones that actually shine are her family, especially Granny Smith. But Applejack gets completely shafted when it comes to pretty much everything. I don't like the fact that they made her a silly pony again, that they made her a stubborn, I take care of things myself, I don't need any help, I'm going to go back and revert to how I was at the beginning of season one. We didn't evolve her character at all. So yeah, I didn't like that. I didn't like that whatsoever. But I did like her family, so that's fine. When it comes to after that one, I think it's a term of visuals. The Rainbow Dash micro was super weird. It was really strange, but I liked the way it looked. And I think it was, I'm saying like in order, like Applejack will be number 10, number 9 will be Rainbow Dash. I liked the fact that Rainbow Dash was loyal and good to the entire town of Ponyville instead of being a jerk, which is something that the show likes to do a lot. Mm-hmm. Like they, oh, okay, we need a jerk for the episode. Who's going to be Rainbow Dash? Okay, let's go with that. It always works. And it works because she has a big ego, but that was the one comic, the one story where she was able to repress her ego and get it out of the way. The problem is that the comic is so weird. There is a David Bowie reference, for God's sake. How weird can you get? Okay, let's see, what else? In the number 8 spot, it will be the... No, it will be the Fluttershy micro, yeah. Easily so, because that comic was really pretty. It was super pretty, but it did absolutely nothing with the character of Fluttershy. And it was kind of insulting when she goes Flutter Rage towards the end. It did have a couple of very good rarity moments, but it's the Fluttershy micro. Rarity has no business being good there. It's supposed to be a celebration of Fluttershy, and that comic was not. Very pretty, but it wasn't a good celebration of Fluttershy. The number 7 will be the Spike Micro. Mm-hmm. And the reason why the Spike Micro is number 7 and it's not higher, despite how much I liked it, is because, again, visuals are great. I love the character of Spike, but the whole setup is unnecessarily forced. Mm-hmm. In that you don't really have... there is no business for Spike to be getting sea monkeys in order to put forward a story about him being more responsible. You could have done it with anything else, but a weird aspect of the comic that almost breaks it, but I really like the way they resolved it, and I really like how good the character of Spike was. Number 6 will be the Cutie Mark Crusaders micro. If only because of the way it looks. It is such a pretty comic. It looks like it was illustrated by Beatrix Potter, this awesome British author and an artist of kids' books. And it was really good. I really liked that. It was good stuff, visually speaking. Story speaking, it was very basic, but it was harmless enough that it wasn't giving a bad lesson to the children. And it wasn't insulting for the adults for them to read. On the number 5 spot, I will put the Celestia micro. Wow. I put it there. It's not all the way up, but I put it right there because it does give a good benevolent view to Princess Celestia, something that the show kind of forgets to do. It forgets to make Celestia a likable, relatable, and good character, which is something that the micro does really well. And hell, you can't go wrong with a cameo from Gordon Ramsay in your comic either. If it wasn't for the ending that is like too family friendly, like I said, a perfect world, we will have a comic where she dies. The teacher that Celestia is trying to protect, she will die, but not in that comic. But aside from that, it was a very good comic. Now this is where it gets difficult for me. What comic do I put on number 4 and number 3? Okay. This is where I go sappy and I go, okay, I'm going to organize them in the level that how much they made me cry. Oh, so God. The number four is going to be the Twilight Sparkle Micro. To me, this is one comic that gets saved for the writing, because the writing is so good. The character of the librarian character, Jade Singer, is such a good character. She's so sympathetic, and the chemistry that she has with Twilight, it's so good. Like, it is funny to see a comic that actually gives itself a quiet scene twice, actually, in the same comic, with just Jade Singer and Twilight sitting at the table having dinner. And they work off each other so well. And it has such a touching ending in that Princess Celestia appreciates the fact that the talent of Jade Singer is recovered for the world to enjoy, but mostly she's happy because she has her friend back. And that is such... That is so pretty. That is lovely. But in terms of tear-jerking power, nothing is better than the Pinkie Pie Micro. And that will be my number 3. Mostly for personal reasons, like I told you, the story with my teacher, how it mirrors almost step-by-step what happened with Pony Achi and Pinkie Pie in the comic. It is a touching musical, really good, really pretty, very well written, and absolutely heartfelt story. And it's impossible for me not to love it. That is one of the best comics in the entire series. Not just the micro, but the entire IDW published comics. But now this is when it gets difficult, because you know the last two that are on the spots, number 2 and number 1.
Like, and Luna.
Which one is going to be number 2 and which one is going to be number 1?
I call bias.
I'm sorry. I am going to be completely predictable, and number 2 is going to be Princess Luna's Mike. And it's going to sound very childish. How am I going to explain this? But why is Princess Luna on number 2 and not number 1, despite Princess Luna having a lot of fun going on with her? Two reasons. One, it did show the journey of the character from beginning to end, but it didn't have that much of a development. Kind of like the shift that Luna suffered on her personality happened in the last 3 pages of the comic, instead of progressively going. And number 2, Tiberius almost completely stole the show. That is something that kind of like, I was like, okay, who do I like more in this comic? Luna or this possum that has appeared in like the first 3 panels and it's already miles funnier than other characters that have appeared in the show? So, yeah, that's... But aside from that, you know what I just said about it. You just heard it. Mm-hmm. So... I really like that one. But yeah, number 1 is going to be definitely Rarity. It's just that is a comic that takes a character and makes the entire comic about that character, and everything is about that character. Every panel, every line, every dialogue, every expression, every single stroke says one thing and one thing only: Rarity is best pony. It shows how good she is, in how flawed she is, and how she's able to overcome those flaws in order to help others, because there is nothing to her more important than making others happy. And that generosity is one of the reasons why I am enamored with her character, because that is something that I completely stand by, that I support, is that we can be good to each other if we work together and we have a common goal. And there is nothing more humble for her to help a run-of-the-mill little farm that is run by these other ponies, that she sees a lot of talent in them, but they are not doing very well. So she goes there to help their talent poke out. And that is so good. And it feels so good. And it's so great. And it's so happy. And it's not happy in the sappy, cheesy way. No, no, it's legit happy. Because one of the things that all of these comics have, from the ones that I like the least to the ones that I loved, is that they don't shilly-shally, there is no bullcrap in them. What you see is what's there, nothing else. There is no cynicism, there is no sarcasm, there is nothing. Nobody rolls their eyes saying, oh, what's this? What a situation. Oh, look at, I got in this predicament. No, they actually do take it seriously. And I like that. That we in taking it so close to heart, they have a lot of fun with it. And that is something that happens with all the micros. So even if I don't like a few of them, or if I find them a bit weird, there is a lot to enjoy on them. So I got a bit preachy on that last statement. I'm sorry. I just got too passionate with it.
It's cool. Like, I totally agree with you, man. Like, with me and my list, I had trouble picking the two of them because the Rarity Micro, it's awesome. It could easily be my number one if Luna Micro was not that good in comparison. So, what you say about the Rarity Micro? Yeah, it's good. I almost changed my opinion on Rarity. Almost made her become my number one, but still, Fluttershy is my number one, still my ace, and the Luna Micro is my favorite still, number one. I can't deny it.
Whereas I find it interesting that Rainbow Dash's Micro occupied the number nine slot on all of our lists. Well, as I said in the review, the world is united by a general sense of
meh. And did we all agree that Twilight was at number four?
I think I bumped her down one when I remembered I needed to rank the Crusaders.
Okay.
No, she was number six on my list.
Yeah, she was number four on my list.
Because Luna was number four for reasons I've already gotten into.
Yeah.
But I also want to point one observation. With all of our top micro choices, all of them featured a great main character, but there was always a really good foil for them.
Yeah.
And it's interesting to keep that in mind as we head into the Friends Forever series.
Oh my god, that one is going to start ugly.
Yeah, we're off to a bad start with that one. But foils bring out the best in characters. And
true.
And much like with Kibitz, where you could say, oh, this guy was so stubborn and stuffy and I hate him. Maybe he's not the personality you enjoy, but look at the good he brought out in Luna.
I mean, with Kibitz, in the Luna Micro, he's the foil for Luna, but he's not that mean. He's not that evil. He's just doing his job like what he's paid to do. He's basically the PA for the princess, or the day shift princess to be exact.
But then you have the ponies of Celestia's Micro, who in a sense, the entire elite of Canterlot are the foil to Celestia.
Yeah, yeah.
They bring out her best. Even though they themselves are not very likable. And James, true. I recall your views on this as well.
True.
Yeah.
But so that's just my two cents moving forward into a new series.
True. And personally, on my plate here, I can't wait to review the Celestia Spike Friends Forever issue. That, to me, is going to be fun.
Whereas I am just sort of bracing for Friends Forever number one.
Oh, don't remind me, man. Oh, God.
I will have one thing good to say about that comic. Mm-hmm. Nothing else.
It
is. Oh, I know.
Okay, two things good about that comic.
I have some praise for it. There's nothing irredeemable in this comic franchise. But I'm kind of dreading the next couple reviews because on one front, we've got the start of Friends Forever, which was a rough start.
Mm-hmm.
And in the main series, we're moving into what is probably been the one I've debated the most fiercely.
Yeah.
Which one? The Discord Fluttershy comic?
Oh, yes, that's next. That one, I have some thoughts on that, but no, it's after that.
Oh,
yeah, the Wild West comic.
The Wild West has spurned a lot of debate, so we'll be hitting that before too long.
See, I mean, Okay, guys, it's Christmas. It's Christmas. So let's not.
It's the season to be jolly. La 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 la.
That's not a word.
That comic.
You know what to do. The fanboy rage.
But we are going to deal with that one next year. We are not going to talk about that one yet. Norman said, it's the Christmas season. We had a. To be honest with you, we did review all of the comics. We are reaching the point where we're going to run out of comics to talk about.
Oh, yeah, true.
Did you guys notice that? That this hiatus has been so long, we ran out of episodes to talk about, and now we are running out of comics to talk about. Next time, you are going to be reviewing Pony Toys.
Actually, you know what? To the ether.
I just thought about something. We should be reviewing the Pony comic. The Pony books. Books.
Oh,
yeah.
God.
Yeah, we should be talking about the books.
James, I don't mind, but the medium of words without pictures bothers me.
The medium that is written for an audience of below 8 years old bothers me. I don't want to go high literary, but at the same time, there's story structure. I have opinions on Twilight Sparkle and the Crystal Heart spell.
It's cool.
I have so many problems with that goddamn book. That is not the best way to start with the books, by the way. Yeah. I was so angry. I was like, why is Twilight acting like this? What's the point of her doing these things? Why is she shoving everybody aside? Why does the Crystal Heart suddenly work out? Like, it's so sudden. It's like, it's doing nothing. Oh, wait a minute. It did something in the last three pages. Oh, you have found the magic of friendship, Twilight. Oh, thank you. The end.
My little pony.
I am there thinking, what just happened?
Oh, but that might be... That might be a review for another day.
Yeah, probably. If we touch upon it.
We're still talking about it.
Yeah. But you know what? Here's the thing. If we do a cross the Red Bridge, and you know what? I have a strong feeling that the episodes might be coming out by that time when we do finish our comics. So we might as well review the show. Who knows? We might enjoy it a bit. We might enjoy it a lot. And you know, Silver will do his thing. And yeah, those are scripted. And this is off the cuff. If you want a more natural flow on things, yeah, we'll try and do an episode review if we can.
Please, I am supernatural even off the cuff.
Oh, natural, you might say, eh?
I will totally love to have you, Silver, for upcoming episode reviews. That will cheer me up. Mm. That will be great. Like, totally personal biased. I just love your reviews and how you word your opinions. It's just... I look at your videos and I am always like, I might not agree with this guy, but I am not hating when he's saying his opinion. That is... And in the internet where you have guys like Movie Bob, oh god, I hate that guy. It's like, he is like so self-entitled and he's like, my opinion is right, you're just wrong about it, you know? It's like, oh yeah, this movie's a POS, and if you think otherwise, you are stupid. It's like, why are people have to be like that?
Personalities. But yeah, who knows? If Silver has the time, we might do an episode review. And, well... Since James, have you watched Equestria Girl Rainbow Rocks?
I did watch Equestria Girl Rainbow Rocks, yes.
So, well, there's that to look forward to. So, you know what? If anything happens, stay tuned to this channel to find out, guys.
And you may not want to hear what I have to say about that movie.
Oh god, now I'm nervous.
Let the hate flow through you.
And you know what?
It's the James Rant show, everybody. Da, 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 da.
And you know what? I'm going to try my best to get a special reviewer for the Rainbow Rocks. I'm going to try my best. With that, James, next year's comic review?
Yeah, next year's comic review. Wow. We are going to start with the Discord Cutiemark Crusaders Fluttershy comic of the main series.
Mm-hmm.
And if everybody is okay, we're going to start with the dreaded issue number one of the Friends Forever.
I wish we can start off with number 2 so we can just carry on, but you know what? We have to do it by numerical order.
It's important to see what didn't go right in order for other people to learn to not repeat the same mistakes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
There's a point to pointing out the weak points so others can learn.
True that. But true that.
That said, I will be hanging on to some of the New Year's liquor.
I'm going to save a few of the bottles over here.
I'm going to get a lot of ice cream.
Anyway, James, take us out.
Well, yeah, I have to take you out. What, you have to go take a... Oh, wait a minute. I was making a stupid silly joke. I'm not going to do that. Well, this has been a fantastic ride. Great year overall. Love doing this. I hope to keep doing this next year. No matter what happens, we're going to still be there for you guys.
Mm-hmm.
I have been James Corck.
And I have been Norman Sanzo without cake. James, get me cake. I want cake.
No, Norman. You cannot have cake.
No.
And I am the Silver Quill, wishing you all a Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas to you all, and have a Happy New Year.
Feliz Navidad, guys.
Adios.